Buenas tardes. Les ruego vayan tomando asiento. Va a dar comienzo la siguiente mesa redonda. La siguiente mesa redonda tratará sobre instrumentos de financiación en Europa y contará con una representación de la EDAD, DigiHome, DigiDefis, con la participación de don Daniel Mosquera Benítez, Project Officer, Air Systems Technologies at the European Defence Agency, Mr. Martin Uvelar, adjunto a Jefe de Unidad de Innovación e Investigación en Seguridad, y don Javier Boiserau Torres, Policy Officer, Defence European Commission, DigiDefence, Industry and Space. Modela la mesa el Jefe de Área de Planificación de I+D de la Subdirección General de Platín, don Óscar Jiménez Mateo.
Gracias, Belén. Bueno, en primer lugar, quería agradecer a la organización por confiar en la Dirección General de Armamento y Material para moderar esta mesa. Quería agradecer también a la audiencia. Sabemos que es una hora muy mala para la mesa redonda. Y, por supuesto, quería agradecer a nuestros tres speakers de alto nivel que vienen representando a distintas instituciones europeas. El objetivo de la mesa, ya se ha introducido, es discutir sobre las oportunidades de financiación para nuestra, en Europa, para nuestra base tecnológica industrial, especialmente dirigida a pequeñas y medianas empresas, a startups, innovadores. Entonces, bueno, sin más, voy a dar paso al primer speaker, que es el representante de la Agencia Europea de Defensa, Daniel Mosquera. Daniel es máster en Ingeniería Aeronáutica en la Universidad Nacional de las Fuerzas Armadas en Venezuela. En 2004 obtuvo un grado en Sistemas Aeroportuarios en la UPM también, como parte de un programa de cooperación internacional entre la Organización Civil de Aviación y AENA, el proveedor de servicios de navegación española. En 2020 se unió a la Agencia Europea de Defensa y actualmente es el Project Officer del CAPTEC de Sistemas Aéreos. Anteriormente ha trabajado también durante 13 años en ISDEFEN, la Ingeniería de Sistemas para la Defensa de España. Y bueno, entonces era el jefe de la unidad de innovación en la Dirección de Desarrollo de Negocio. Daniel, adelante. Bueno, no he comentado, voy a dar paso a cada uno de los ponentes. Tendrán entre 8 y 10 minutos para las presentaciones, introduciré algunas cuestiones para discusión y daremos también, si tenemos tiempo, paso para preguntas por parte de la audiencia. Daniel, adelante.
Muchísimas gracias, Óscar. Se escucha bien, ¿verdad? Aquí siempre tenemos dudas. Magnífico, pues gracias por la invitación. Y pues como ha dicho antes Óscar, soy Project Officer de Sistemas Aéreos, pero también trabajo en temas de innovación, por eso un poco también la presentación aquí. Así que para nosotros es un placer estar aquí hoy para compartir los temas de innovación con un foco en los temas de SMEs y startups. Continuaré la presentación en inglés, puesto que ha sido un acuerdo que teníamos antes, con lo cual continuaré en inglés. So, I will not speak a lot about the European Defense Agency, because we want to maximize the 8 minutes we have today. But as you can see in the slide, there are three pillars that we are working in the agency. So we are doing the support to the key capabilities. We are stimulating research and technologies. And also we are ensuring the military voice in all the wider EU policies. And this is when you see cooperation with other entities like DigiDefis and DigiHome. So today, and this is especially important for the SMEs and the startups, but whatever I say today is for all, even for the industries. Today I will be talking about two aspects, which is the CAPTEX and also defense innovation, which as you see is transversal for all the activities. Because innovation is not only a matter of research, but also is a matter of capabilities and is a matter also about cooperation. So if I stay, let's say, 4 minutes in the CAPTEX, what CAPTEX are? CAPTEX are technology groups that we arrange in the European Defense Agency. And in these groups, we have 15, and in these groups is where we promote cooperation in research and technology. And we do this not because we need to do research, but because the research we do this is to stimulate the future defense capabilities. So indeed, there are things that we need right now, but we need to think in the future always. The picture you see here is very important because all the projects that we promote within the member states in the EDA are based on collaboration. So we need at least two member states to collaborate in some thematic areas. And for this, member states, they bring the national industries, entities, research technology organizations, SMEs, startups. There are, because we are talking about funding, there are two key funding tools that we have in EDA. The first one you see there, it is called operational budget. This is budget that EDA we already have and we can spend. And for you, for SMEs, it's very important that you monitor this information in our website, because everything that we promote with the operational budget, then we do using public tendering. So you need to go to the EDA website and check what we are publishing there. Usually what you will find there is technical feasibility studies in support to the CAPTEX, and I will give you in a second an overview of what CAPTEX we have. Then we have the other tool, which is called the ad hoc projects. This, for the first one, we are talking about 100,000 a year, 100 1,000 a year. So it's very, very limited. But for the next one, which is the ad hoc projects, then we are talking about millions. And for that, we are talking, it's open also to the SMEs, but it's mainly driven by industry, academia, and RTOs. And for this is what we need, cooperation with the member states. So in the CapTex, we do projects. This is the idea, but before we need to draft two documents that you will see in the screen, strategic research agendas. In these agendas, you will see what the member states together with the research community have identified for the future. And you will see also what we call the technology building blocks. So in the communities, in the CapTex, you bring the communities together with the member states. We set the agenda and then we go for the projects. And last but not least, you see here at the end that this CapTex also is a very good networking team where the people is meeting and them not only working at EDA, but also them creating partnership for other funding tools. These are the CapTex we have. I said before we have 15. So all the entities are free to apply for the CapTex, and the approval is based on the member state. So any entity from Spain should be approved by Spain. So in conclusion of this, and as you see here, the best way to explain this is with an example. So what you see here is a ad hoc project that we kick off in November. And when I say we, I see our colleagues from the GAM, because Spain is leading this project. It's a project in the aerial domain, the domain I know the better, but this is applicable to all of them, on the automatic air to refueling. In this domain, industry from Spain, industry from Germany, but also research technology organization from Germany has applied, and we are working in the next 2 years in this project. For the SMEs and startups, in this kind of projects, I will say the best tool is to work together with the industry, so the industry can bring you inside these projects, and better, the best way is via subcontracting. You can apply, but I will say, but these big projects, industry is needing some capacities that are in the startups and the SMEs, so you can join, is open for all of them. And then, because this is a question I always receive, so EDA is working in these projects, so we all love numbers. So there you have some numbers. Let me stress this again. When we are talking about CatPIS, EDA, we don't have the budget. Member states has the budget. So the numbers you see here is the contributions that the member states, in this case, for instance, Spain, Germany, are bringing to these projects. And as you can see in the numbers, we are talking about big numbers. So you see a tendency, and currently we are managing 54 projects in this domain. So in this first phase, I will say SMEs and startups needs to partnership with the industry. But now we are talking about innovation, okay? So remember, CapTex and now innovation. So in the innovation part, recently EDA has launched the Hub for EU Defense Innovation that we call HEDI. And I can give you more details about HEDI after the speech, but as you see highlighted there are few things that I would like to highlight. When we talk about the Hub for EU Defense Innovation, we are not talking about EDA. EDA is leading the hub, but a hub is bringing people together. So the hub should not be done in isolation. So if you see, the mission is to ensure innovative capabilities are delivered for EU. And we need to do this in cooperation with all the stakeholders. And my colleagues from DEFIS and the EHOM are only examples, because the hub is bringing everybody together. How we do this? In the hub, we have launched 6 services. And when I said recently, I mean last year, June 2022, is when this hub was formally introduced and presented. And as we are talking mainly today for SMEs and startups, then you need to focus in these two services I am showing to you. Innovation prices, innovation challenges also, and the EU Defense Innovation Day. So I will give you in details on that. So innovation prices, this is, let's say, the most important tool that EDA and the hub has right now to promote the participation of SMEs, startups, and individuals. However, these prizes are open to everybody. So usually what we do is to select a topic in November, December, we open a call for ideas, and what we ask is industry, academia, RTO, SMEs to provide some ideas on a concrete topic. What you see in the screen is the topic for 2022. In a minute, I will show you the topic right now. And I want to highlight something. If you see in the slide that the participation of SMEs is very big. So more than 50% is participating in these prizes. What we ask is a 5 pages maximum describing the idea. And usually we have 1 or 2 prizes. And as you can see here, I will show you what we are talking about. So for this year, deadline is 15 June. And as you can see in the slide, in the left part, there are 2 topics for the prize. We have 2 prizes, 30K each one, because what we want is to promote the ideas. So we are not asking for for you to present projects or results, but ideas. Bring the ideas to EDA. The call is open until 15 June, and the evaluation is completed by November, and in December we do the award ceremony in the EDA annual conference. Then on the right side of the screen, you will see another tool which is part of the prizes. This one is more focused into the early research careers. So what we have is the Research Technology Innovation Papers Award. This time, what I say is close because it is recently closed. The announcement of the 3 winners for this year will be done in the EU Defense Innovation Days. I will give you some information in a minute. And we are planning to have this call all the years. So especially in February, I will say maybe November this year, we will open the new call for the Papers Award. And the process is the same. We ask you papers, scientific papers, 8 pages maximum, and then we select the best 3, and the best 3 we promote. This, the results coming from these calls, then we get the results and present the results in the CAPTEX, because here is about identification, and then in the CAPTEX is about implementation. That's why it's very important that overall everybody, but especially SMEs, to enter the process in here, bringing ideas in the Innovation Prize and the Papers Award, because after that we will incorporate the information in the CAPTEX. I think the timing is okay. So 2 last messages I want to give to you. The EU Defense Innovation Days, we will celebrate the 2nd edition this year, 31st of May, 1st of June. It is true that the event is based on invitation. However, I am leaving in the screen and in the presentation that can be distributed to the participants the link to register. Feel free to register if you want to participate, because usually at the end, maybe some free spaces are there. In this event, we are proposing some stands, not as big as FeinDev, so very humble staff stands. And I want to give you a number. 80% of these stands are based for SMEs. So 80% is a very big number. SMEs are presenting the research, technology, and innovation activities in FeinDev. Very last information. When we are talking about EU funding, there are a lot of funding tools. In EDA, we have one tool which is called EU Funding, and it's a base of a questionnaire. We invite, it's open for everybody, it's an open service. We invite especially SMEs and startups to follow the link, put your information in the tool, and the tool will provide you an overview of all the funding tools where you can apply, not only EDA, but also Next Generation EU, Digital Europe, Horizon Europe, EDF, and so on. So this is, when you are starting in the domain, I would suggest that you get into the EU funding tool, complete the questionnaire, and then see the results so you can identify what to participate. I will be happy to answer the question after, if I understood well, and you have our contact details, and I think by the time now is exactly the time. Thank
Daniel,
you, Oscar.
Thank you very much for your comprehensive presentation. I think we are running a bit late, but so I'll move on to the next to our next speaker, Javier Boisadeu, de la DGDEFIS, de la Dirección General de Defensa y Espacio de la Comisión Europea, es coronel del Ejército, comenzó su carrera, su puesto aquí como Second National Expert en julio del 21. Anteriormente ha sido jefe de la unidad, jefe de unidad de la Unión Europea en la DGAM, en la Dirección General de Armamento y Material. Durante su carrera militar ha tenido distintos puestos en distintas organizaciones civiles y militares, como the Spanish General Staff Corps, European Security and Defense Policy y High Level Course o de Master Security and Defense. Es contribuidor, contribuye regularmente a conferencias en distintas instituciones, entre ellos CSDEN, y durante su carrera militar ha tenido distintas posiciones en varias unidades, como los Headquarters of the Spanish Armed Forces, ha sido en los NATO Headquarters, la Joint Force Command y en el Headquarters of the Allied Forces of Europe. Javier, the floor is yours.
Muchas gracias. Ahora, ahí está. Bueno, primero, muchas gracias por la introducción y gracias por la oportunidad de dar a DGDEFIS la posibilidad de explicar el EU Defense Innovation Scheme. Voy a aprovechar que puedo hablar en español y lo voy a hacer en español, aunque se me vaya algún palabra en inglés. Pido disculpas. A partir de ahora, voy a llamarle EUDIS. Porque son sus siglas en inglés. Bueno, el EUDIS lo que pretende es, EUDIS es parte del Fondo Europeo de Defensa, y lo que se pretende es crear un ecosistema de innovación más fuerte dentro de defensa. Perdón, que tengo un poco la garganta un poco tomada. El nivel de ambición es invertir cerca de 2.000 millones de euros procedentes principalmente del Fondo Europeo de Defensa, pero también de otras fuentes de financiación que procederé a comentar más adelante. Todo esto tratando de coordinar, por supuesto, con la EDA y con la OTAN, también su proyecto, el proyecto de innovación que tiene Diana. En la pantalla verán que hay 5 tracks o vías básicas que luego explicaré más en detalle. La primera trata de conseguir la migración de tecnologías civiles al mundo de la defensa, la participación en Technological Challenge y Hackathons para impulsar tecnologías innovadoras, la creación y la participación de una red de innovación en temas específicos, obtener financiación adicional de diferentes formas, y la participación lo máximo posible de pequeñas y medianas empresas y de organizaciones de investigación. En tecnologías, sobre todo, también disruptivas. El EUDIS empezó ya en el año 2021, pero únicamente está evolucionando, y en el 2023 tratamos de conseguir que coja velocidad de crucero. En el 21 únicamente hubo 64 millones de euros básicamente en los topics que eran para pequeñas y medianas empresas y tecnologías disruptivas, y ya en el 2023 tenemos 224 millones dedicados específicamente a EUDIS. Pueden ver en la tarta la distribución de cómo van los millones. La parte más importante es para aquellos topics dedicados a pequeñas y medianas empresas y a tecnologías disruptivas. Tengo que aquí hacer mención, la parte verde también está incluido un training para SMEs que vienen del mundo civil y desconocen el mundo de la defensa, pues se les va a prestar un apoyo bastante considerable para conseguir integrar esas compañías. Y luego la parte gris, que es tratar de migrar proyectos civiles que tengan interés para el mundo de la defensa, que es en esta transparencia muy completa, quizá demasiado completa, pueden ver el programa de trabajo para el año 2023, con todas las categorías, cada categoría con los topics diferentes. En color azul, los topics que son específicos de research, y los de color verde, que son de desarrollo. Y llamo la atención que se fijen en los topics, lo que está expuesto en color naranja. Concretamente pueden ver que en ciber, en energía y medio ambiente y en materiales y componentes hay topes específicos para incorporar tecnologías civiles. En abajo a la derecha verán que se organizará un challenge de, no, perdón, en transformación digital se organizará un challenge. Habrá un hackathon de 600.000 euros y se va a organizar un network de innovación en la parte de materiales y componentes. Comentar que también tenemos en la parte de abajo a la derecha que ponen Blending Facility Equity Funding, esa parte es la que luego trataré como financiación, y creo que nada más. Paso a la siguiente. Empiezo a ir en detalle por las vías diferentes. Tanto los hackathons como las Technological Challenges tratan de conseguir poner nuevas ideas e iniciativas en competición para obtener un resultado final interesante para la defensa. Este año se organizará un hackathon por 600.000 euros, en el cual pues, el tema que se va a tratar es de los sistemas de transmisión de los diferentes sistemas de mando y control que hay dentro de la Unión Europea. Se organizará un Technological Challenge que se va a tratar sobre el lenguaje humano, cómo conseguir la interoperabilidad, los diferentes idiomas que tenemos dentro de la Unión Europea, cómo integrar todo eso. Y esto pues se organizará un Technological Challenge en el cual el organizador recibirá una financiación de 7 millones de euros y luego se distribuirán 18 millones de euros por cada uno de los equipos que participen. El Technological Hub, que lo que pretende es promover las cadenas, promover cadenas de suministro para obtener la autonomía estratégica que necesita la Unión Europea. Para eso, pues vamos a crear unos hubs, unos núcleos, unos networks que atraigan todas las pequeñas empresas que estén interesadas en los temas que se vayan a tratar. En el hub lo que se dará, pues el hub como tal lo que tratará es de proporcionar instalaciones para hacer test, apoyo técnico a los beneficiarios y entrenamiento en la gestión de negocios. Este año se va a tratar el tema de mantenimiento, reparación y ensamblaje, pues lógicamente dentro de las cuestiones logísticas. La siguiente vía es la atracción de ideas desde el mundo civil, es decir, tratar de conseguir la sinergia entre tecnologías civiles y tecnologías militares. Y entonces ahí ven que hay 14 millones de euros para la categoría de ciberdefensa, 25 millones para la parte de energía y transición medioambiental y 20 millones de euros para materiales. Con la parte de financiación, la Comisión Europea ahora mismo está trabajando con el Fondo Europeo de Inversiones para cerrar cómo se puede conseguir el atraer, o sea, que el fondo, el EDF, financie, el Fondo Europeo de Inversiones financie y atraiga inversores del mundo civil que estén interesados en todo ello. Esperamos que para julio esté ya el acuerdo firmado y entonces se pueda empezar a trabajar en esta parte. Pero esto aquí lo importante es lo que se pretende es dar financiación a las pymes que lo necesiten. Y finalmente los topics que son directamente, que están relacionados directamente con tecnologías disruptivas y específicos de pymes. Ahí pues hay casi 90 millones de euros dedicados para todo esto. Bueno, pues en nuestra agenda ahora mismo estamos tratando de impulsar lo máximo posible con charlas como esta, el EUDIS. Queremos crear una página web específica del EUDIS. Estamos ya empezando a trabajar con el 2024 y bueno, tratamos de mantener un diálogo continuo con la EDA y con la OTAN para que no haya, pues tratar de obtener sinergias y que no haya duplicidades. Para terminar, si quieren tener más información o más información en detalle, yo les animo a que participen en el Info Day, que el 28 y 29 de junio se celebrará en Bruselas, pero que también se puede seguir de forma virtual desde España. Y todo, muchas gracias por su atención y disponible para cualquier pregunta. Muchas gracias.
Javier, muchas gracias por tu presentación. Espero que tengamos tiempo para preguntas. We are running a bit behind the schedule. Let me introduce you to the third speaker. Martin Ewelhor works at the European Commission at the DG Home, the DG for Migration and Home Affairs, as Deputy Head of Unit for Innovation and Security Research. Previously, he has worked also at the Commission at the DG Connect as Head of Sector for Cybersecurity, Industry and Innovation. He joined the European Commission in 2008. Martin studied political science and sociology in Mannheim, Baltimore, and Bruges. Martin, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Oscar. Can you hear me? Yes. Okay. Thank you for the invitation. I'm very much looking forward to this discussion with you today. I'm also very happy to see so many people interested in this conversation about EU funding. As Oscar said, and by the way, voy a hablar inglés, pero luego también me defiendo en español. Así que luego, si hay preguntas, luego podemos seguir en español, ¿vale? So I come from, let's say, the equivalent of the Interior Ministry at European level, so DG Home. We manage this part of this large research and innovation program, which is Horizon Europe. The part that we manage, together with another part, DG Connect, is about civil security. Okay. So there is a distinction between defense and civil security, but there are many overlaps and there are many topics, you know, to seek synergies. Overall, we speak about between 200 and 250 million euros of investment in research and innovation in the civil security per year. I'm proud to say that many of the applications, many of the equipment which today is used by police, by firefighters, emergency services, also probably many of the products exhibited here at FEINDEF, at some point in time came up through research projects of the framework programs of Horizon Europe on security. So, just to, you hear you have some examples like dark web crawlers, automated border gates, etc. What is special in our part of this program, which is that it's very focused on the end users. Okay, so it's a program that brings together research, so universities, RTOs, industry, and end users. Okay, and typically these are consortia, so groups, you know, collaborative research projects of, I don't know, five or ten partners typically, and from at least three different member states. And in most topics, we have this requirement to have end users on board. So you really, and it's very application focused. So it's high technology readiness levels, and the and it's not by coincidence that we manage this from the equivalent of the Interior Ministry, because we work, you know, we have the policy, we have the legislation at European level on civil security, so on countering terrorism, also on, you know, let's say civil emergencies, disaster resilience. And so we basically want to complement what we do on the legislative and in the, let's say, policy arena. We want to complement this with supporting research and innovation and, let's say, an industrial policy, if I may say so. The way our part of the program is organized, we have certain what we call destinations, so fighting crime and terrorism, border management, disaster resilience. Then we have something cross-cutting, which is called civil security research and innovation. And then we have infrastructure protection and cybersecurity. So our core business in the European Commission is we establish what we call the work programs. So those are biannual documents which basically set the research priorities and the funding priorities. Where does the money go? I have a similar slide as you, which is similarly bad in terms of format, probably worse. But so again, so in, just to give a few examples, in fighting crime and terrorism, we have a topic on, you know, cybercrime, or we have topics on, you know, forensics. In border management, we have topics on, you know, supporting customs authorities, you know, aerial surveillance, you know, of, you know, sea or land borders, for example. We have, you know, kind of bio. So by the way, you know, if you go to an airport now and there's a biometric, kind of there's an automation, like an automated analysis of your biometric passport, you know, likelihood is that, you know, this equipment was basically kind of brought to market with the help of our program. So then protection of public spaces, critical infrastructure, so disaster resilience, the entire kind of CBRNE, let's say, group of topics. So supporting firefighters, supporting emergency services, let's say predicting, mitigating natural disasters. And then we have this cross-cutting topic, which is civil security research and innovation, which you know, supports communities of users, which kind of supports, let's say, thematic networks in relation to this civil security research. Apart from the mere, so just to go back, the so the benefit of participating in our projects can be presented as twofold. You know, one is, okay, you get financing for your research and development, you know. And so it's basically pushing the research, you know, horizon further, creating knowledge, you get a subsidy for it. But apart from that, there's the networking element. So you get access to people outside your current, let's say, community. If you're a researcher, you have access to industry and you have access to end users. If you are an industry, you know, with a base in Spain, you know, you have better chances to, you know, to open up additional geographies, additional markets, you know, through by working with people from other European countries and beyond, by the way. So part of this, so apart from the individual project level, the way we organize this on the civilian side is what we call the Community for Research and Innovation in Civil Security, CERIS, where we, again, it's organized, it's mostly workshops, bringing together, again, research, so researchers, industry, and policymakers and practitioners along particular themes, you know, themes such as fighting child sexual abuse, or anti-drone, or fighting bioterrorism, you know, just to name a few examples. And so there you have people from the national level, sometimes the regional level, EU policymakers, and you have experts coming from the projects. So again, even if you're not yet in one of our projects, you really may want to sign up for our series newsletter to get the alerts for these events, for which you can register even if you are not a beneficiary in a current project. We also have these thematic networks, or networks of practitioners, for example, bringing together people working in the member states on procurement, okay? So then you have procurement agencies from all over Europe talking about how to be more innovative in what they do, okay? And like this, you know, through the work of this network, what we try to do is we promote innovation. But for you, this may be interesting as a kind of a vector to reach a broader audience, to draw attention to whatever your capability and your competence is. And then last but not least, there are other European funds. As was already said, the, let's say, EU funding landscape is quite rich. Rich also in the sense of complex. So there, on the one side, there's the DG Home funds, you know, for border management migration on the one side, and for internal security on the other side, where we try to have what comes out of the research projects, we try to have it picked up and deployed, so to really cover the entire, let's say, innovation cycle. And then there's the link, obviously, here on this panel with the Defense Fund, where dual use is good, dual use is desirable, but I'm speaking here about the civilian, let's say, the civilian part of the EU program. So it's good if what you're doing in one of our projects generates knowledge which can also be exploited on the defense or military side of things, but it shouldn't be financed from our project, okay? So you can work on drones, you can work on unexploded ordnance, for example, in our part of the program, but just the focus then should be on civilian activities, you know? If then this leads to knowledge and competences which you exploit on the military side of things, even better. Okay. Voilà, and that's it in a nutshell. Last but not least, if you're interested to know more, I would refer you to the national contact points for civilian security research, and they're actually sitting here in the audience. So you have Marina Martinez, right, and Maite Boyero, who are very skilled and very experienced in advising people interested in our programs. And we also have an info day combined with a brokerage event in Brussels coming up, and I think it's just a week before the EDIS one. So it's around the 15th, 16th of June in Brussels, right? With that, Oscar, back to you, thank you.
Martin, thank you very much for your comprehensive presentation. I think we still have some time for questions, but I don't know if there are any questions from the audience. I would like to introduce something for discussion. Una de las grandes preocupaciones de los Estados miembros es precisamente viendo las distintas iniciativas que hay de financiación y las distintas iniciativas relacionadas con innovación, cómo evitar duplicidades y explorar complementariedades entre los distintos sectores. Me gustaría que contaseis un poco desde vuestra experiencia, desde las distintas organizaciones, qué medidas se toman, si se toman o si habría que tomar más medidas para evitar estas duplicidades entre programas de trabajo que puede haber en distinta temática. Se me ocurre en EBQ, espacio que puede ser muy dual entre la parte civil y de defensa, o incluso entre organizaciones como la EDA, la DigiDefis, NATO, otras agencias como la Agencia Espacial Europea. ¿Qué medidas hay o se toman o debería haber para evitar estas duplicidades y explorar complementariedades?
Vale,
por
pues,
favor.
Perfecto. Pues yo siempre he pensado que el problema no es que haya duplicidades, sino no conocer que las hay, porque en el tema de I+D, que haya duplicidades no siempre es malo. ¿Vale? Tanto la EDA, la Comisión, como DigiHome, y podréis refrendar mis palabras, hay muy buena coordinación. Cuando he contado lo del tema del hub, hay actividades en las que la EDA toma la iniciativa y la Comisión está con nosotros, y hay otras actividades que la Comisión toma la iniciativa y nosotros apoyamos. El marco de cooperación es bueno, todo en esta vida es mejorable, evidentemente, y lo importante es que la información se muestra en todas las páginas web, y en este tipo de eventos que hacemos, como podréis ver, siempre estamos haciendo mención al resto de actividades. Por tanto, ahora mismo lo que tenemos es una coordinación bastante fluida, identificando cuáles son esas actividades que están en programas de trabajo conjuntos y viendo quién toma en algún momento. En los prices, por ejemplo, puede que la actividad venga primero de la EDA, en otras actividades viene de la Comisión, y por tanto pues nos vamos coordinando.
Bueno, por parte de DigiDefis, bueno, con la EDA tenemos una comunicación continua, hay una coordinación entre el Digi, entre el hub de ellos y nuestro EUDIS. Ahora, por otra parte, nosotros uno de los temas que he comentado es que tratamos de absorber tecnologías desde la parte civil al mundo de defensa. Entonces, bueno, hay una parte específica que requiere tener que ese proyecto haya sido financiado por la parte civil de la Comisión. Por lo tanto, tenemos un grupo de trabajo que está en continuamente, bueno, EUDIS está empezando todavía, está cogiendo velocidad de crucero, pero se trata de coordinar dentro de la Comisión Europea con todas las direcciones generales pues todos los temas de innovación y conseguir que no haya duplicidades y conseguir sinergias, desde luego.
So just to complement on this, I mean, at the very practical level, you know, if I work on my work program, you know, which establishes the funding priorities on the civilian side, obviously at different stages of the process, I consult the colleagues, you know, and that's the entire European Commission, you know. So then you have people from the environmental sector commenting and the people from the defense sector commenting. Apart from that, there's also, you know, in areas where, for example, there's work on a strategic research and innovation agenda, or there are kind of, let's say, stakeholder groupings where we, previously I was working in cybersecurity and there was also this interaction with the defense. You know, where you have kind of a civilian cybersecurity stakeholder platform, for example, okay? And the same exists, let's say, around EDA, for just to give one example. You can bring those together and you can compare the roadmaps. Okay, will we ever get rid of, you know, will we have complete and perfect coordination? it will be difficult. But also the, you know, the adaptation, you know, in some ways we have similar technologies that we adapt for purposes which are different, but then it goes, you know, there is a lot of dual use aspects. But so it's the work programs, but it's also what we do around, you know, with our different stakeholder platforms, where we can interlink, you know, and coordinate.
Gracias a los tres. Bueno, quiero añadir que también desde los Estados miembros estamos intentando trabajar para evitar duplicidades cuando trabajamos los programas de trabajo EDF, de proyectos que apoyamos en la EDA. Tenemos nuestra labor. Creo que hay una pregunta a la audiencia, si tenemos algo de tiempo.
Hola, bueno, ¿se me oye? Sí. Bueno, soy José Luis Pérez Díaz, catedrático de la Escuela Politécnica de la Universidad de Alcalá y fundador de Counterfog, un spin-off que, bueno, nos premiaron el año pasado nos premiaron con el mejor proyecto en la Digi Home de investigación. Mi pregunta es muy práctica. Nosotros tenemos una tecnología que claramente puede ser aplicada a defensa por descontaminación en RBQ. Para participar en la EDA, en cada país el proceso es distinto. Yo tengo una serie de actores interesados de distintos países que podemos hacer un proyecto respondiendo a uno de los topics, pero me encuentro que en cada país necesita una autorización cada uno de los socios, sí. O eso entiendo. Sí. Entonces, sí. No hay uniformidad en el proceso, es cada uno independientemente tiene que ir a su ministerio y solicitar la autorización, ¿no?
Exacto, gracias por tu pregunta. El proceso es uniforme, lo que pasa es que cada entidad, como la EDA es participada por los Estados miembros, cada entidad tiene que ser aprobada por su Ministerio de Defensa. El proceso es el mismo. La entidad tiene que contactar al CAPTEC y el CAPTEC esa membership application lo pasará al Estado miembro correspondiente. El Estado miembro correspondiente lo aprobará y todos podrán participar en el CAPTEC.
A través del CAPTEC, entonces, es el que centraliza
el proceso.
Sí,
efectivamente. Has nombrado NBRQ, por tanto, lo que te diría es entrar en nuestra web, contactar al moderador del CAPTEC de NBRQ o a través de mí hacerlo. Ahora mismo no tenemos moderador porque está la vacante publicada, pero bueno, siempre hay alguien de guardia, ¿vale? O sea, que hacerlo. Y a partir de allí entráis en los CAPTECs y a través de los CAPTECs presentáis vuestras ideas y esa tecnología la podéis también desarrollar en los CAPTECs.
Gracias.
No sé si hay tiempo para alguna pregunta más. Sino agradecer a los ponentes las magníficas presentaciones y a la audiencia por aguantar en estos horarios un poco tan intempestivos. Gracias.
Muchas gracias. Gracias. To the floor and make me see your energy because me not play no hide and seek. Office is the thing you ever make me feel.